you can find beginning on page 94 in the front of the ELW. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God,
have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
We sing as our gathering hymn number 834, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. 834.
Thank you.
yourself all those who go astray. Preserve your people in your loving care, that we may reject whatever is contrary to you and may follow all things that sustain our life in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Congregation may be seated. We invite all children, young and old, to come to the children's room. Hey, yeah. You children, come on, you stay where you're at. We won't get you children. How about that? Today we are going to hear a story, one you've probably heard before, about a shepherd who has a whole flock of sheep, and one ends up getting lost. And so I thought it would be important for us to have an object lesson, a sheep that... Well, this is embarrassing. Lost a sheep. Should we just skip this moment, or should I? Per your request. It's going to require a little bit of sleuthing, and I'm wondering if any of you from where you're at can see, it's about like yay high, white and like made of foam board. Anybody see any sheep brown? Spotted it? Here? God bless me right here. Here it was. It was here all along. Oh, goodness. Well, here it is. Now, because we had nobody come forward, I'd like to award this special sheep to Noah. Would you be willing to let Noah have that in his room?
Sure.
Now. Foam board sheep's going to be okay if we don't find it. Right? And it's not a real crisis here. But when you were talking about real living things, it's worth taking the time, no matter how embarrassing it is, to go and seek whatever is lost. And even if you and I have heard the story of the shepherd who goes after the one lost sheep, or the woman who goes after the one lost coin a million times before in our lives, and you probably have, you probably heard it in a story, sung it in a song, seen it on flannel board if you've been in churches long enough, the thing we sometimes forget is that Jesus tells these stories as a way of helping us to think about people who get treated like they can just slip through the cracks and get lost. Nobody ever intends to say you don't matter. Nobody ever intends to write somebody off forever. But man, is it easy to, especially if we can find some reason why they made too many mistakes in their life. Therefore, if they're lost, it's their own problem. They've had too much baggage in their past, therefore it's their punishment for doing bad stuff. That's why we've given up on them. If we are willing to take the time to find the foam board sheep, it was going to be fine either way because it's just foam board. If we're willing to take the time for an inanimate object like that, if a shepherd's willing to go after one lost sheep, if a woman's willing to go after one lost coin, how much more willing are we called to be in light of how God seeks after the people who feel like they have been lost through the cracks? If you've been there before, you feel like either you've been forgotten or written off or pushed aside like it didn't matter because of whatever reason people come up with, and often it's respectable religious people who are the ones pushing others off to the side like they don't matter. If you've ever been there and know what it's like to be found and told you are worthy, you are beloved, then of course we are called to be about that work day in and day out, to reach after people that it is so easy to forget are there, or to forget might feel like they have been written off, like it's okay to give up on them. The God we meet in Jesus is relentless, does not give up on a one of us. And so, if you know what it's like to have been found, maybe we can be called to be people who seek out and reach out to folks who are just waiting to be told, you are worth the search. Hear that right now, every last one of us. You are worth God's search. Somebody you know this week is waiting to hear you tell that to them. And maybe, just maybe, you'll be a part of their story of how they discovered themselves found by grace too. Would you be willing to pray with me right where you are? Good Lord, you amaze us with your ways of seeking us out when we have gotten ourselves lost and entangled, when we have done nothing to seek you first. You have a way of reaching out to us. And if we have learned the importance of even finding a phone board to sheep on a morning like this, help us to trust how deeply important every last one of us is. Not just us in this room, but everybody in this whole world you so love. Thank you for that love, Jesus. We love you too. Amen.
With the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The The saying is sure and worthy and full of acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. For that very reason I received mercy, so that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ may display the utmost patience, making me an example to those who would come to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal and invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I have lost." Just so, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The congregation may be seated. So, true story. I happened into the office here at the church on Friday morning and found on the work counter in the office these few wooden pieces. And was a little bit perplexed, because we don't usually keep random wooden pieces in the office. And then I saw a post-it note that was set on top of them, and the post-it note said something like this. Dear church people, I'm one of the people who cleans the church, and I was in here on Thursday night, and was cleaning, and accidentally bumped up against the picture frame you all had on the wall in your entryway, and knocked it off the wall and onto the floor, and the frame broke. I'm very, very sorry, and I will report it to our employer so that if we need to rectify things and buy you a new picture frame, we will do that. This was my mistake. And then I put the pieces together. I realized, oh, that's what I'm looking at here. I realized there were pieces to put together, I guess. Underneath this was indeed a glass rectangle that was not harmed, and underneath that, church family photo we had taken, I don't know, 10, 12 years ago with everybody who happened to be here that Sunday out on the front steps of the church, and they're all safe and sound. All of you and your photographic selves are just fine. But the frame is broken. And there, for a moment, as I realized clearly what had happened and what was there laying in the office in front of me, I thought my first reaction was, oh, who cares? It's just a picture frame. Fair enough. It's just a picture frame. I even thought to myself briefly, do we even need that up in the narthex anymore? Maybe people don't even notice that it's there. And then immediately, my brain went to thinking of all the list of stores right here in our county where I could go and buy a new picture frame, the cheap ones, expensive ones, everything in between. And I was starting to think to myself, my goodness, a cheap picture frame, that can't cost very much at all. You know what? I'll just buy another one and replace it, problem solved. And then, once my brain started going like this, my brain then continued to think out, you know how much labor and energy it would take to try and fix that picture frame, right? Because you need to get, well, probably wood glue, and then you maybe need to reinforce that with screws because you don't want to have it up and then fall again, so you might need to get screws. You'll need to figure out what's the right diameter of of screws. You want them thick enough and sturdy enough that it'll actually hold it together, but you don't want to split the wood that's there. You're going to have to get your clamps. You're going to need one for the horizontal, one for the vertical. You're going to make sure that you don't break that glass that's there. This could be like a half a day's work. And so as I'm thinking to myself about the work that's going to take and why it would be such a foolish idea to try and fix this thing, I have convinced myself to go to the local Walmart or Dollar Tree to buy the cheapest frame I could find, and then something changed my mind. Somebody changed my mind, I should say. I bet you can guess who it was who got to me. It's Jesus. Jesus, he's always spoiling my plans to do the cheap thing. And not because I regularly consult Jesus on matters of framing and art supplies. When we have a new piece of artwork to hang at the house or a picture of the kids, I don't make that a prayer request. Jesus has other more important priorities than helping me figure out which frame to buy. But this was one of those times when, without Jesus bidding, without my bidding Jesus, his voice was there making me think again about just throwing out what's broken and buying another. And it occurred to me, all in the space of these few minutes staring at these broken pieces on the office counter, how easily I have been persuaded by a million voices in our culture that when something breaks, you give up. When something is lost, when something is damaged, you give up on it, because we live in a world and in a culture where you can always buy more, and you can buy another cheap one, and the thing that you have now doesn't really matter, just get rid of it. When you have another one, it's easy to find another. If you lose one, don't bother making much of a search for it. That's going to be too much time and energy and labor and stress, and you might not even be successful. Just get another. There's a million voices in our culture that say that. When you lose something, don't bother looking for it. That's a waste of your time. When something falls off the wall, don't bother fixing it. Just get another one. We live in a culture that treats everything almost as disposable, forgettable, replaceable, and interchangeable. And I was about to do with the picture frame. And then I hear Jesus tell stories. And Jesus has a way of upending what I've become convinced is conventional wisdom about the disposability and replaceability things. Jesus tells stories like, hey, there was a guy who had 100 sheep and one of them gets lost. So of course, what does he do? Well, anybody in our culture would go, sheep make more sheep. Who cares? At some point you gotta write off the loss, right? Conventional business sense says you gotta build some margins in your business. Every so often you're gonna lose a sheep. Let's make a list of all the possible ways a sheep could get lost, and you'll never recoup that investment there, right? If a sheep's been eaten by a wolf, there's no point in searching for it. You'll never find anything and won't be able to get it back. If that sheep has hurt itself or killed itself or drowned in the creek, because sheep are not terribly intelligent animals, there's no point in going after it. And for that matter, let's say you find a sheep and it's wounded. You're going to spend more time and energy and money nursing it back to health. Well, here's the thing about sheep. They make more sheep. You can leave them alone, right? Conventional business sense would say, just write it off. Give up. Sheep are interchangeable, right? Who cares about that one? Leave the rest of your flock. Watch over them. They'll make you more sheep in due time, and you won't lose any more time or effort or resource nursing a sick one back to help. Just give up on it. But that's not how Jesus' story goes. In Jesus' story, the shepherd leaves behind the 99 who are doing all just fine and goes to great lengths to go find the one that has gotten itself in trouble and brings it back home. Jesus tells another story, right? There's a woman who's got 10 coins and she's lost one of them. So, of course, what does she need? Well, in our culture, we'd say something like, think about how much time and effort it's going to take to search for that coin. And if it's going to take you longer to find it, and the wages you've lost by searching for that coin, just give up on it. You can make more money. That's how money works. Do more labor. Do more work. Give up on the one that's lost. After all, I don't know how many times I have to have conversations with my kids, who I would hope are paying attention to my example, which means maybe my example is not as good as I think it is, who when they lose something, a sock, a toy, a video game, a something, so quickly the response is, eh, that's okay, you can get us another one, we can buy another one. Where are they getting this from, except that they live in my household? Well, they must be modeling this. They live in this culture where everything is disposable and replaceable, and you don't spend the time to fix or repair or mend or restore what's lost or broken or damaged. Jesus dares to tell us God runs the universe counter to that conventional wisdom that says everything is disposable, everything is replaceable, just get another. Jesus tells surprising stories where people go to great lengths to find the thing they lost. Not another one like it, not another cheaper one at Walmart or the dollar store, but the very thing that was lost, regardless of what the cost is. Because Jesus is convinced God isn't just interested in the idea of commodities God doesn't just see us as investments to be written off or losses to be cut. But God sees you and me in all of our you-ness and all of my me-ness and all of who we are and says, I love them. These people particularly, I will not lose them. So Jesus is that voice. He told me, maybe don't just give up on fixing the thing that's broken or writing it off. Jesus is the voice that says, yeah, go after the lost sheep. Jesus is the one who says, search the house until you find the coin. And what? Go to great lengths. Once you find that coin, throw a party and invite all your friends over to found the lost coin. Who does that? Who throws a party? You rub it in your neighbor's face. I lost my coin, everybody. And then spends more money than the value of that coin in appetizers and hors d'oeuvres at that party to invite everybody over to celebrate the lost coin. Of course, that's just it. This was never just about lost objects, any more than our children's moment a little bit ago was about a foam board sheep. Jesus tells these stories about the way God views people, about the way he views people. And in a culture that treats even people like they're disposable, forgettable, they made too many mistakes, it's their problem, write-offable, God does not give up on any last one of us. Sometimes we forget that these stories, these lovely stories about lost things being found again, aren't just given in a vacuum. Jesus doesn't like sit down with children and open up a book of fairy tales and say, let me tell you a fun story about sheep. Jesus tells these stories in response to the respectable religious people who are upset that Jesus associates with all the wrong kind of people. You know, them sinners, them tax collectors, them people who've done all the wrong things, who are not repentant at all, who don't see the error of their ways and have made too many mistakes in life ever to be given a second chance, or maybe we've given them second and third and fourth chances and we're just ready to give up on them. Jesus tells these stories because he's gotten a reputation for hanging out with all people with the wrong reputations. In the first century, in a Near Eastern culture, when you eat with somebody, you're saying to them, I accept. You're saying, you are my social equal. You all know what it was like, I'm guessing, once upon a time when you were kids at the big family Thanksgiving dinner and you had to sit with the other cousins at the kid table, right? You know, you don't really belong. You're at the kid table. You're not a full stakeholder. When you get to be old enough to sit at the grown-up table, now you have arrived. We'll take that notion and turn that up to 11. That's what it's like in the ancient world in the Mediterranean to be invited to sit at the table with somebody. It's Jesus saying, you're not beneath me, you're not less than, you're not lower than, I treat you as my equal, I accept you, I love you as you are. And Jesus has made a habit of reaching out to all the people, all the respectable people won't even associate with anymore, and deliberately welcoming them to his table, inviting himself over to their houses, and telling them, I'm not waiting for you to get your act together first, I love you as you are, I seek you as you are, I'm going out to find you as you are, I will not give up on you. In a culture like ours that has decided everything is disposable and replaceable and interchangeable, that's revolution. In a culture like ours that so easily says, something is broken, who cares, get another one. It's lost, no big deal, you'll just find another. Jesus insists, no, every last one of us is precious and beloved and chosen by God. And we don't get to say, of anybody, they've made too many mistakes, I'm not going to care about them anymore. They may have had too much baggage in their path, they've done too many bad things, you know what? I'm giving up on them. God hasn't, so we don't get to either. The difficult thing about a story like this is it's real easy for us church folk to imagine that, of course, our sins aren't terribly bad. We're basically respectable, good, decent people, but there's those people. We've all got our own personal list of people who've done terrible things that are outside the bounds of mercy or forgiveness or too many chances that have been asked for. They don't count. We are going to cut our losses. We just don't care about them. Except God hasn't given up on any of us, despite the fact that we keep finding ways to mess up, screw up, get ourselves broken, and get ourselves lost. Maybe you've seen, there's this video clip that I see resurfacing every couple of months or so that is an honest, it was a real-life situation from an actual modern-day shepherd. And the scene actually depicts this shepherd pulling a sheep that's fallen into a crevice and pulling him out by the hind legs, pulling him out, setting that sheep back on solid ground again. The sheep sort of shakes itself off like my dog shaking the rain off her back. And then you're like, okay, now the sheep is understood. Don't fall in the crack again. And I kid you not, two more leaps, and that sheep jumps right back in that very same crack all over again. I remember seeing this video thinking, oh my goodness, how pitiable, how sad. I'm so glad to be a human who doesn't make that kind of mistake over and over and over again. I'm so glad. I'm so much smarter and better and more moral than that sheep who keeps getting himself in a crevice like that. Except, every Sunday, we gather and we open the very first page in our hymnal and we say things like, "Hey God, sorry, it's us again. We fell into the crack again. Here's a list of all the ways we mess up again in our words, in our actions, in our thoughts, in the things we did and the things we didn't do. We're really sorry we messed up, and we thought for sure last week was the last time we weren't going to do it again, but what do you know, here we are again, we messed up all over again." And grace is extended to us as free gift all over again, week in and week out, despite the fact that we keep making the same mistakes all over again. A less patient God, or a God that had been fooled by the myth of consumerism, would say, "You know what, I don't need these sinners, I'll get new ones, I'll make new ones, who won't mess up anymore, I'll replace them, these are just not worth the trouble." A God who ran the universe like I sometimes do with the things in my household, with the broken things or lost things in my household, would say, "I'm done with them. They're not worth the effort." Thanks be to God. Ours is not a God who sees any one of us as replaceable, disposable, or interchangeable, but sees you and says, "I love you for who you are. You are not just an investment of mine where I'll cut my losses if the profits aren't high enough. You are not just an object I can replace with another identical version. It's you I love. It's you I seek. It's you I am after. And the party will not be the same without you. So I'm seeking after you." So often, we religious folks hear a story about lost sheep and lost coins and hear this as a way of telling all those people we view as sinners in their lives that they got to get their act together. If you do enough to show God that you're remorseful enough, you turn a fresh page, if you get your act together, pray well enough, come back to church, do whatever, then God will love you. That's not how these stories go. The sheep doesn't do anything to get itself found. The coin doesn't do anything to get itself found either. This is all about God who reaches out to us in our lostness and says, "I seek you out because you are precious as you are. I love you as you are. Come back." We are going to head back out into the world that is surrounded by a million of those voices telling us to treat not only objects but people like they're interchangeable, disposable, and then can give up on folks when it just gets too hard. I can't stop that there will be all those voices continuing to tell us, "When a thing breaks, just give up on it and buy another cheap one. When a relationship breaks, just give up on it. When people seem to make bad choices, just give up on them." I can't stop that there will be those other voices. But we can, in this place, decide we will dare to listen to Jesus' voice above all that other racket and embody something different. So, when we do things like naked hoagies to help people in our community who are going through a crisis time, we do not say, "Well, they clearly, if they're in a bad position, they made bad mistakes, there's no hope for them, we just give up on them." Nope. We will offer a response and help and assistance. Or when we raise money for Family Promise, instead of saying, "Well, if you've ended up homeless, it's your fault, you must have made too many bad decisions." Nope, we will not do that to other people. We will instead say, wherever people have found themselves in bad situations, how will we offer God's grace a second, third, or fourth start? Because God won't give up on us, and God won't give up on them. Maybe there's somebody in your life this week who's waiting to hear that God's love keeps seeking them out. Maybe there's somebody in your life who is waiting for you to embody it in your actions and make it real. So it's more than just a story on the flannel board, but a story they see is true in the way you keep seeking people out in love. So here is my promise to you, my dear friends, this week. I'm going to take the time this week and take the broken pieces, because I'm convinced Jesus won't let me give up on a broken thing or write it off. And I guess we'll see what happens when we refuse together to be people who give up on broken things or give up on lost things. Because every time I look in the mirror, I see one more broken lost thing that Jesus hasn't given up on. Amen. Congregation rises as you are able. We sing our hymn of the day, 588, "There's a Wideness in God's Mercy."
Thank you. Let us confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
With the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, let us pray for the Church, those in need, and all of God's creation. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into bread, so let us gather our prayers for the Church. Your people receive mercy, and your grace overflows in our lives. Fill your Church with faith and love, and give understanding hearts to those who work to strengthen our ecumenical and interreligious commitments. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your creation groans as it suffers the impacts of pollution and lack of care. As the seasons change, renew us in us the will to protect plants, animals, and habitats. Bless us with bountiful harvests that all may share. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your world is shattered and the nations rage. Remember us in your mercy. Teach wisdom to our elected leaders so that we know peace in our world, peace in our homes, and peace in our hearts. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your children wander homelessly and the hungry cry for bread. Seek out those who are lost or lonely, anxious or depressed, struggling with addiction or illness. Provide for those in any need. Especially we pray for Jim, Cody, Shirley, and Warren. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your work is done in this congregation with our hands, feet, voices, minds, and hearts. Build up the ministry of this community, that we may serve our neighbors and welcome the stranger in your name. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your blessed saints who have died now rest in your presence. Give us thankful hearts for those who have been examples of faith in our lives, and receive us with joy when we come to share eternal life with you. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Gathered together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
You're invited to share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
Thank you.
good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vines. Nurture us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. Eat, saying, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we pray boldly in the words Jesus gave us, saying, our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Table, Jesus said, you are welcome. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
We sing number 208, Praise to You, O God of Mercy.
Oh,
nourished us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We sing as our ascending hymn number 779, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.